Thank you, Gavin, very much, and thank you, everybody, for attending. We'll go ahead and get started. We're encountering a little bit of technical difficulty, so if a video doesn't play, bear with us.
Our internet connection is just a little slow, but I think we can work with it. What we're going to do for you today, we're going to give you a sneak preview of the MOOC that we've been developing over the last year. We just ran a pilot in June, and we'll give you some feedback and let you see what our first participants thought about the MOOC. And Blackboard, by the way, sponsored the development of this MOOC, which we're very grateful for. The MOOC is open and free for participants, and we will at the end share how you can sign up for the two MOOCs that are upcoming and get updated information on the MOOC that you can share with your colleagues and take to your institutions. So the significance of inclusive online course design, we know it's important to have accessible online courses so that all students can access the content in online courses at the same time, so that students aren't waiting for accommodations and doing things that make it difficult for them to succeed in online courses. So it's really, really important that we let all students in online courses have an equal place at the table where they can share their ideas. And Aaron, you were recently a student at the University of Montana. You have a pretty vivid experience about that.
Yeah, I won't go into huge detail on it, but one of the last classes that I took was a consulting class that really took advantage of the features of a learning management system, and all of the course materials were posted within Moodle. All of them were accessible documents. All of the exams and quizzes were done using Moodle quizzes, and they were done created in an accessible way. For that course, I didn't have to request a single accommodation. I had access to every single class handout at the same time as everybody else. I literally took the same exams in the same room at the same time as everybody else. Didn't have to request any accommodations, and that's really the goal.
Great. So we had two overall goals, Aaron. Do you want to mention those?
So we had two really overarching goals for the design of the MOOC that we did. So the first one was that we wanted to model inclusive practices so that participants would have a clear understanding of accessible online course design and delivery. And we also really wanted to provide a good example of creating and engaging an accessible online course that's also very visually appealing.
Great. And our target audience was K-12 educators and higher education audiences, but really anyone in industry and government. We've had a number of people come up to us in those areas that are very interested in accessible design. So whatever field you're in, there's something in the MOOC that can help you with your online training.
So for any of you guys who may have listened to Marlene and I present at previous Moodle MOOCs or like previous DV World, you may have heard us talk about our four key accessibility principles. They're just very basic principles that are a really good starting point for getting going on making your content accessible, and those are creating a good heading structure, providing good alternative text for any images, creating descriptive hyperlinks, and the proper use of lists and tables. These four concepts really have been applied very consistently, and we'll talk more about kind of the consistency of the course later. But we really have taken those key principles and applied them consistently throughout the course to try and make this just as accessible as it could possibly be. And as a student user, I'm pretty happy with how that turned out. the MOOC is it's designed to be a moderated course, so there is that instructor engagement. Marlene and I are there. We are responding to forums. There's an opportunity for a live 1 hour a week office hour where you're able to join us in a Blackboard Collaborate session to ask us any questions you may have about the content or provide us any feedback that you have about the MOOC. It's designed to take 4 weeks. It's a four-week moderated course, and the MOOC is completely free. So it's free and open to anybody, and we ask you to participate.
So we're using a theme that Moodle Rooms created that's been released to the open source community. It's called Snap. And in Snap, the name of the course is a heading one, and it's always a link on every page in the course. And then in the table of contents, you see our topics. So we have really six topics: course overview, working with text, working with data, working with images, working with audio and video, and working with uploaded content. So we wanted to be very concise, and we didn't want 20 million topics. We wanted to keep it very concise so people could find their way around and get really succinct information. And even though we developed this in Moodle Rooms, it's really LMS agnostic. and all the principles we cover pertain to any use of an LMS. So let's go into topic two, just take a sneak preview, and we'll look at working with text. And I'm going to just open another tab just to get around that slow internet connection. So let me just go over the structure here. And every topic has the same structure. So we start out with an aspirational video that's about 60 seconds to help people engage with the topic and understand why it's important. So let me just play this real quick aspirational video. Whoops,
text plays a major role in online course design. Thoughtful use of text can improve the reading experience and make course navigation clearer for everyone. Therefore, this topic examines properly structured text headings, text styles and formats, and descriptive text hyperlinks.
So people are focused now on why this is an important topic. Some people, we really tried to build universal design for learning and model that in this course. So some people, sometimes Aaron doesn't like to watch videos. There's other people who'd rather just read the transcript. So we had it captioned, but we also provided a way to hide show the transcript in case somebody did not want to play the video or was in a location where they just didn't need sound going on or where they were looking at the MOOC. So that's consistent in all of our topics. And then we have three focus areas in every topic. You're seeing my editing tools, the pencil and edit section, because editing is automatically on for designers in Snap. The students don't see that view, but you're seeing my building tools, which is totally fine. But notice in the aspirational video, we talked about headings, text layout, and hyperlinks. And so we've built sections, three sections in every topic for the three focus areas that are critical. I'm going to go into hyperlinks and show you how we built the MOOC on books. So here's the table of contents for this book. We start out every book with an introduction, and then we go down through clearly labeled chapters. We wanted people to be able to come back and read things specifically that they wanted to review and find it quickly and easily. So we were very concerned that we chunked our information and just didn't create great big long scrolling pages with 20 million things on one page. We also decided on using the word example or examples in this case. And you can see in chapter 4, 6, and 8, it has that example colon at the beginning. And that means that in those chapters, there are video demonstrations of assistive technologies working with, in this case, it's descriptive links. In this case of chapter 6, it's URLs. And in chapter 8, it's non-descriptive links. So it's very easy if somebody wants to go back and rewatch a video, our naming was carefully chosen so that people could quickly find those chapters. I'm not going to open a video just yet, though we will show you some. I just wanted to show you how we concluded. The introduction has a brief introduction and key terms always in every book. And then in the conclusion of every book, we restated what we thought was important. And then we added an H5P interactive activity so people could test their knowledge before they even left the book. And the test your knowledge H5P activity is just three simple questions. So do you want to say anything about H5P, Aaron, and then I'll do the activity?
Yeah. So I imagine most everybody in here is probably familiar with H5P. It's getting to be pretty popular. It's these eight great HTML5 interactive activities that you can embed into websites or into learning management systems that allow you to do so. We contacted H5P, and we were told that there are five H5P content types now that have been fully vetted for accessibility. And so we tried to take advantage of all five of those throughout the course for these test your knowledge activities. So the types that we have here, we've got true-false questions. We have single choice set, which is where you have one response to pick. We have multiple choice, fill in the blank, and flashcards. So different books they all have one H5P activity at the end, and it varies depending on which book you're in. So it really mixes it up. It's a great way for testing your knowledge.
Right. So, and we wanted to really increase engagement and interactivity, so that's why we thought we would give this additional quick test your knowledge. This is a single choice question set, and I'm just going to work through this. What is the most important accessibility concern when working with hyperlinks? Hyperlinks should be descriptive. Hyperlinks should be similar in color and appearance. Hyperlinks should be similar in length. And hyperlinks should indicate if they link outside the current site. So, we haven't done the book, none of you have, but I'm going to click on the answer that I think is correct. I'm sure many of you would know that answer too. Hyperlinks should be descriptive. And it tells me with the green color and the check mark that I was correct. Then it moves me right on to the next question set. What is the problem with click here links? I'm sure you've all seen click here. Click here links take up too much space on the page. Click here links are small and too easily missed when using screen magnification software. Click here links make no sense out of context, such as in a screen reader links list. And click here links are read too quickly when using text to speech. And I'm going to select the third choice. Click here links make no sense out of context. And I'm correct, and it's going to move me right on to the next one, which is a potential issue when using descriptive hyperlinks. Most applications do not support creating descriptive links. Descriptive hyperlinks lose their link properties when printed on paper. Users do not know how to use descriptive links, and it is difficult to rewrite content to use descriptive links. And the correct answer here will be that you lose the URLs when you do print them on paper. And this is a consideration with syllabi. If you put your syllabus in your online course, you can almost be sure that some people are going to want to print that out and highlight things and keep it with them. And you lose the URLs with descriptive links. So what we do is we just put the URL in parentheses if we're writing in Word, and we right-click on it and remove the hyperlink. Because then it doesn't come up in a linked list like Aaron uses with his screen reading software, JAWS. So just remember that descriptive links lose their link properties when printed on paper. So it told me I was correct, and it said I got 3 out of 3. So that's how those little activities work. They're very quick and interactive. So let me just give you kind of an overview now. I'll go back up. We have multiple means of navigation. You can navigate back to the home page of the course by clicking on the title of the course. We also added a return to topic button. So this one will take me, whoa, is that me? This also will take me back to working with text. So we wanted people to be able to return to the topic if they wanted to. Then within the books, there's the table of contents and chapters and ways to navigate around through there. So we have 6 topics all in the MOOC, 3 focus areas, each with a book in the MOOC. So we have 16 books, like you just saw, in the MOOC, complete with multimedia content. And we really try to emphasize the fact that using multimedia is a reinforcement of universal design for learning, because you're using multiple means of representation. Students who get text-heavy online courses, it can be really hard for some people with print disabilities or other types of disabilities, people who just have a hard time with straight text all the time. You can see that we tried to avoid clutter and streamline and really chunk things down so that people could easily go back and locate segments of information that they wanted to review. So, Aaron.
Yep. So, as Marlene said, one of the things we really focused on in the design of this MOOC was consistency. We wanted it to be really straightforward to navigate, have a consistent experience across devices, across assistive technologies and browsers. So as Marlene said, you know, each topic has 3 focus areas, so it's very consistent. We paid special attention to make sure that our terminology was very consistent throughout the course. We always use the same term to indicate something, which is actually a WCAG guideline. And then we also wanted to ensure that people could navigate very consistently. So one of the things that we'll show you again here in just a little bit are some of those navigation mechanisms that we created to make really consistent ways of getting around the course. You can get to wherever you need to go from anywhere in the course. One of the things that we found in the workshops and trainings that we did at the University of Montana was We do what we do a two-screen presentation. So there are two screens. On one screen, you have what's on Marlene's computer, which is the normal view that most folks are used to seeing. And then on my screen, you would see the specific technologies in play. And we would usually have screen reading, screen magnification, and high color contrast enabled when we would do those workshops. And they were very powerful and well received because people, it helped that they could see, okay, here's how to create accessible content, what you see on Marlene's screen. Here's why you need to create accessible content, what you're seeing on my screen. And that was a very powerful way of conveying that information that we really wanted to emulate in the MOOC. And so we did some thinking about it, and the solution that we decided on was to provide a lot of multimedia content. So we have demonstration videos using assistive technologies throughout the course. So in the course, you'll find demonstration videos of the course concepts as they apply to users of screen reading software, users of screen magnification software, and users of speech-to-text or speech control, whatever you'd like to call it. In this case, this MOOC, we used JAWS for Windows for the screen reading, Magic by Freedom Scientific for the screen magnification, and Dragon Naturally Speaking by Nuance to provide those speech-to-text videos.
So let's just show you a couple of the videos. I'm going to go to Descriptive Links, Chapter 4. And in this case, we took the JAWS icon from the company and we made a dragon icon. So we are demonstrating both how descriptive links work with a screen reader and with a speech-to-text software program. So let's look at this.
Using descriptive links will ensure that all users understand where the link will take them, regardless of how they choose to access it. For screen readers, it's important for links to be descriptive as the surrounding non-link text may not be read out depending on how the user navigates. I'll demonstrate. This page contains several descriptive links, which should be understood by users of screen reading software, regardless as to how they navigate. First, I will read the whole sentences.
Bullet, learn more about Moodle by visiting the link Moodle homepage. Bullet, learn more about the link Americans with Disabilities Act.
In the context of the whole sentence being read, I am able to understand where the links will take me. Now, let's see if I navigate by pressing Tab.
Tab, Americans with Disabilities Act, link. Tab, General Services Administration, Section 508, website link. Tab, learn more about webbing, link.
When I use Tab to navigate, only the title of the link is being read. I can still understand where this link will take me, even with only the title of the link being read. Now let's look at the links list.
Links list dialog. Links list view. Learn more about webbing. 12 to 30. To move to items, use the arrow keys. Web content accessibility guidelines. Moodle Docs on accessibility.
Just like when using Tab, only the link titles are displayed here in the links list. However, since these links are descriptive, I can still understand where they are going to take me. Descriptive links are particularly important for users of screen reading software, but they also improve the visual experience and help prevent confusion about a link's purpose. Descriptive links are a perfect example of how accessibility can improve the experience for all users.
And let's look at the Dragon demonstration that Devin Armstrong, one of our colleagues, created for us.
Descriptive links are ideal for Dragon users because the descriptive link text can be used to activate the link with only a single command. I'll demonstrate. Descriptive links are ideal for Dragon users because the descriptive links can be used to activate the link with only a single command. I'll demonstrate. Wake up. Click Americans with Disabilities Act. Go to sleep. With descriptive links, Dragon users only have to provide a single command to access hyperlinks. This provides the learning experience as individuals using a mouse and keyboard and provides maximum efficiency when accessing content.
And Aaron also mentioned that we also show screen magnification for low vision users, so that gives you a sense of how we're demonstrating how people interact with online content. And some of the feedback we got from our pilot participants was they didn't know. It was really eye-opening to see those kinds of interactions. They just weren't aware of them. So you can see how we've used multiple means of representation to get our ideas across and really lined up with Universal Design for Learning. Let me go now to another book. Let's go to STEM content. STEM content is in working with data. And I'll go back to that book in just a minute. But let's look at how we worked with math. So here we used audio only. And we showed how screen readers interact with math formulas. So I'll play this one for you.
B equals fraction, B plus or minus the square root of B squared minus 4C over 2R, math content.
I don't think I started that right at the beginning. Let me try that again.
X equals fraction, B plus or minus the square root of B squared minus 4C over 2R, math content.
So that's a nice development that didn't used to be there a few years ago, Aaron.
Literally within just the last couple of years, this really became a mainstream thing. Prior to a few years ago, you would have to download a very specific assistive technology, get the plug-in, hope the plug-in was compatible, and now this just works by using the default equation editor. It's a huge advancement.
We also work with sonification. So I'll go to Chapter 7, Graphs and Multiple Means of Representation. Let's see, here we have, I think, Aaron, you're going to talk about math tracks. Let me just swing down here and open the math tracks link while you talk about it.
So this section of the STEM book was probably one of the most fun parts of the course to create. We have charts and graphs that we also include long descriptions of, and we have sonified versions, so audio versions, essentially, of those graphs. All of this was generated using a single application and a free application at that. It's a bit old, but it definitely gets the job done. So it's called MathTracks. It was developed by NASA. Marlene's got the site pulled up there, you can see it. And it generated all three of these different means of representation. So MathTracks was able to generate the visual, the charts. It was able to generate the textual in that long description, and it was able to generate that sonified version just by simply entering in an Excel spreadsheet or typing in a specific formula. It generated all of that material for us.
So you can see this was developed by NASA, and it's been around for a while. A lot of people may not know about it, but it was a 2006 NASA Software of the Year runner-up, and we really had fun playing with it. I'm going to go down. I went to the library with a Photoshop image of the graph and created a 3D tactile object. Sorry about my booming voice here. I usually don't boom.
I've never had a booming voice.
We'll go past the parabola, and we're going to go down to a graph generated from a data set. So, get excited and I start doing all kinds of crazy stuff with my mic. Let me play the sonification of this.
That as it would go up, the pitch would increase. As the line went down, the pitch would decrease. And it had an overall trend by the end where you could tell that the pitch was getting lower. So it was fluctuating, but it was slowly kind of moving downward in trend.
And here is the description or the alternative text that it generated for us. It's really nice. Alternative text can really be, it can take some work sometimes, and it's really nice when a little tool like this generates your alternative text, and then it gave us a data file, and I'll just open this really quick, and you can see the data that was built on, so that's provided. Some people may want to just interact with that, And then here's the 3D tactile object that, and this is the actual object in my hand that we created. And then because it's a fully online MOOC, we had to photograph it and put it in, but that's the tactile version for feeling what that graph might feel like.
Created on a 3D printer.
Right. So that's a really, that's been a fun part to the STEM content. There is a really great project coming out of the University of Colorado Boulder on accessible simulations in science and STEM content, and we're hoping to add some of their content with their permission to the MOOC so that we're, for us, the past year has been exploring accessible STEM content and working with our faculty in the sciences, so we're really hoping to expand this part of the MOOC and always have new developments going on here in the MOOC so that it's kind of a living thing. It's not just a static MOOC that never changes. I'm going to go back to the homepage of the course, and I'm going to go back into working with text. Our internet seems to be faster now, Aaron. Aaron talked earlier about how we have interactivity. So after people see the aspirational video, they go through the focus areas and read those books. Then there's activities within each topic. And here is the first week of the course covers the course overview and working with text. And we wanted to know right off the bat how many people wanted to earn certificates from the MOOC, so we were prepared. You can earn certificates, and Aaron will talk about that in just a little bit, but we do have two certificates that you can earn by taking this MOOC. Then we had an assignment every week. The assignment was done in a sandbox course, so people who wanted to practice their accessibility skills or revise a course of their own in their own LMS or get a sandbox course on our site, we gave them the option to get started on working with accessibility in this LMS or in their own LMS. So during week one, they would work with adding text into their practice course. And it was up to them how much, how little, if they were just converting a course or creating new text. And it was not required. Nothing's required of people. It's all voluntary. They can do what they choose to do. And then here was the link to request a sandbox course. People who requested the course, then the last week of the MOOC, we engaged them in a workshop activity where let's say I have a sandbox course. I would evaluate three other sandbox courses and give people feedback, and three other people within the MOOC would evaluate my sandbox course and give me feedback. And then we look at those courses too. So we had a mechanism for evaluating courses, giving each other feedback. People wanted to see other courses besides their own. So that was our assignment every week, was to work with the topics, whatever the topic was, text, images, data, uploaded content, whatever. The idea was that they would practice and have a real audience to give them feedback. Then we also had a practice quiz in every topic, and those are just 6-question quizzes, but we really built a lot of feedback into those quiz questions, so they're more like tutorials. If you get the answer right, great, you got the answer right, and here's the link to some additional information about this topic. If you miss the answer, then we gave them additional information about why that answer was not the correct answer. So they were getting tutoring. We built that ahead of time, so during the actual live delivery, we were in the forums in the office hours. But Moodle itself was doing the work in the quizzes for us because we spent quite a bit of time providing feedback in those quizzes. And then here we use Blackboard Collaborate, which is a highly accessible web conferencing system. That was where we had our live office hour every week. And people attended that and really wanted to chat and talk with us about things, ask us questions and talk about situations at their institutions. We were all in different time zones. There were people in North America, South America, Europe, and Asia who volunteered to be part of our pilot, so a lot of people couldn't attend, but some people were able to do that, and they helped us select the time of the office hour through a choice activity. Then our forums, we started out week one with introduce yourself, and Aaron will give you a count about how busy that forum was. That was our busiest forum because we wanted to welcome each person to the course. And then every week there was questions or comments, and that was also heavily used because people wanted to ask us questions. So that's a look at what a topic is. It's an aspirational video, 3 focus areas with very structured books, with multimedia content, and then activities for engagement and probing deeper, asking more questions.
Thank you. So as Marlene mentioned, we just finished running our first pilot run of the MOOC. We did it in the month of June. It was a total success in our opinion. So for the pilot, we had 100 seats available. We capped the participation at 100 just because it was a pilot, we wanted to get a feel for any issues that came up, and we're very glad we did a pilot first. It was a great experience. So out of 100 seats that we had available, we managed to get 93, so good turnout there. Marlene mentioned the discussion forums. The discussion forums are probably the hardest thing to keep up with in this course. So we had 94 discussion forums in total, or I should say threads within the various discussion forums that were there. 45 of those were in the introductions one alone. So 45 in introductions, and then we had 41 in the various questions and comments forums that we had. And each of those threads had on average between 2 and 10 replies. So it was quite a bit of forum activity to keep up with.
Okay, and we actually met one of our MOOC attendees, met us last night at the reception. We were able to meet in person and talk, and I know there's other people that may be here that enrolled in the MOOC, and it's really fun when you get to meet in person after you teach online, as many of you know. The quizzes, as I mentioned, there were 6 quiz opportunities, 5 in each of the major topics, and then we had a review quiz. And the review quiz was 10 questions, not 6, and we randomized the questions out of the whole question bank. So, and you could take the review as many times as you wanted to get as much feedback as you wanted. So they could take the review quiz once, get a certain set of questions, get some feedback, and then take it again and get a whole new set of questions and get more feedback and just test their knowledge. And people took advantage of that opportunity. Office hours?
Yes, office hours. As we mentioned earlier, we had an office hour available each week. We did that 3 of the weeks in the MOOC, so week 2, 3, and 4. And so what we did in week 1 was we provided a choice activity. And in that choice activity, we had a list of different times that we would be available. And we gave the participants the option to pick the times that kind of worked best for them. And then the time that worked for the largest majority of the participants was the time that we went ahead and used for that live office hour.
And of those 93 enrolled participants, 46 requested sandbox courses. I looked through, I'm still looking through those courses, and I'm going to download those and really analyze those courses. Some people requested a sandbox course and didn't do much in them, but some people did a lot, and some people really gave extensive feedback. So it just varied by person, and it was totally voluntary. They did need to have some content in their sandbox courses to participate in that workshop activity. And I'm going to scroll down, and now those requirements are up on the screen, Aaron.
All right, cool. So Marlene mentioned earlier that we have 2 certificates that are available for in this MOOC. We have a certificate of participation and a certificate of completion. For the pilot, out of the 93 participants that we had 6 who went all the way and received a certificate of completion. And then we had another 6 that went and did all the requirements to get a certificate of participation. With the certificate of completion, you really had to kind of go through all of it. So contributions to the discussion forums, you had to take the various quizzes that were available in each topic, get a passing score, and then you also had to do the workshop activity with the sandbox courses. For the certificate of participation, for the pilot at least, we really just focused on are you posting in the discussion forums. That's one of the things we're kind of considering revising for the next round of the MOOC.
And we left the MOOC open. It closed 2 weeks after the month was over, so people had time to download their courses and keep them. if they built them in our system, or if they wanted to go back and review content, or if they wanted to, they needed to go back in and get their certificate of completion or participation. So we gave them extra time. We didn't just close the MOOC at the end of the month. Some people said that they wanted to retake the MOOC, and they were looking forward to seeing the changes that we implemented. So here's a little bit of feedback we wanted to share with you from the pilot. The pilot, we really learned a lot. We don't have any, just a brief overview for you of some things that we know we need to improve. A lot of people weren't familiar with SNAP, and they were confused by the navigation. I made a video. I don't think people watched it, how to navigate the course. I thought it was really clear, but apparently it wasn't. So we either need to move that video into week one out of course overview, and we know we just need to have some other people test it who have no familiarity with SNAP. Then there was a little confusion about requesting a sandbox course and the workshop activity, so we need to streamline that content because that's really meaningful work for people to engage in, and we want to make sure that that has complete clarity. And there was also some need for clarification of terminology. People didn't understand what we meant by Atto. Atto is the text editor in Moodle, and we love Atto. Atto has really got some great accessibility features, but other LMSs might be using TinyMCE, whatever. So we just needed to do some clarification, and we know we need to go back and make it more LMS agnostic. Right now it's very Moodle and Moodle Rooms-ish with some reference to, you know, be sure and check with your tech support team about what text editor you're using and what the features are there. So we know we need to do that. We thought we'd share just some quotes from participants. We had a reflections discussion the last week of class, and we asked them to give us some feedback. And it was all positive there. They were such nice people. We had people from Moodle HQ, Helen Foster, Mary Cooch. We had people from Blackboard. We had educators and people from all over, and they gave us some really nice feedback. We just wanted to share with you three little quotes because our goal was to see, do we really impact the design practices of the people that take the MOOC? Can we really do that? So the first participant quote is, "I'm extremely grateful for this eye-opening experience. I have been teaching and designing online courses since 2007. I also facilitate a 9-week rigorous course in online pedagogy and design in Blackboard and shorter courses in D2L and Canvas. However, this course has opened my eyes to all the things I need to improve upon in my design and help my faculty create far more accessible courses."
I'll go ahead and read the second one. So the second one we had was, "I particularly enjoyed the videos of the assistive technology in action. Seeing the effects of poor design was a real wake-up call and made me even more aware of the importance of making courses and course material accessible to all."
And the last brief quote, "This course was very informative. You have managed to take a large amount of very good information and make it easy to understand." So just wanted to share that with you. I'll open that up, Aaron, and take you to our parking lot.
Yes, we were very happy with that feedback. So one of the big things we wanted from that pilot was getting all that feedback, was to get a list of things, changes, improvements we can make to the MOOC. And as Marlene said earlier, we want this to be a living MOOC. We want it to update. We want it to change. There's always new technologies, new advances in accessibility, and we want this to reflect that. So we created what we call the parking lot, where we could list out all the different things, the updates, the changes that we want to make. We prioritized those updates using what's called the Moscow method, which I promise I did not learn from Star Trek.
you did.
And so we sorted them by must-have, could use, should, would be nice, that type of thing. I'm just going to highlight a couple of really important parking lot items that we have here that are definitely going to be there for the October release. So the biggest one we had was audio descriptions. We want to ensure that all the video content in the course will include audio descriptions, and we plan on working with 3Play Media to get those audio descriptions produced. We want to increase the automation in the course so we can scale up the size of the MOOC. So, for example, when a student or a participant would request a sandbox course, Marlene and I actually had to go in and approve that request. So one of the things we would like to do is eliminate that so that's more automated. That way we can scale the size of the MOOC up and accept more participants. And then we want to beef up some some of the content areas, and one really specific one is to add more information about accessibility testing. So we mentioned the workshop activity with the sandbox courses. The point of that is for one participant to go and evaluate and test the course of another. And so we want to add more information about testing to help the participants complete those activities.
Great. So we're going to move right along since it's 3:13. We'll go to upcoming dates. And this is probably what you're the most interested in if you want to participate in the MOOC or if you want to encourage your colleagues to participate. The next one will be October 15th through November 10th. In the future, there'll be, you know, just the month of October, but we thought Aaron was going to be going to a guide dog school for the blind the first part of October to get his dog Jeb, and then they had a cancellation and Aaron was able to go early. But we're hoping in the future that it'll be the whole month of October. This year, it's October 15th through November 10th. And then it will be April 2nd through April 27th in 2018. So we're hoping for October, April, just get on a really steady schedule with that so we have time in between to upgrade. And we'll see. The University of Montana UM system wants a Montana open online course, a MOOC, but it's Montana, not massive. So we've got lots of demands right within our own state, and we're really happy about that. The Ally User Group, I'm sure you've seen Nicholas and his team around. Nicholas and others, we will be putting information on that website about updates on the MOOC and how to sign up if you want to participate. So that URL, usergroup.ally.ac/dashboard, is where you want to go. And you can always email Aaron and I, ampage87@gmail.com and marlene.zents@gmail.com. So we're available for questions. I think we'll have a few minutes. Just want to say in closing, we're really excited to be able to reach a larger audience and get out of our own geographic area and have more extensive discussions with people around the world about accessibility. So we're really, really excited for this opportunity that's been given to us.
And as we mentioned kind of earlier on, one of our goals was that we wanted to create a course that was visually appealing, engaging, and accessible. It was one of our key goals. And we're very proud of this. We think we hit that goal right on the mark.
Right, so we'll turn it back over to Gavin. We have about 5 minutes.
There we go. Well, thank you very much for that. That was very interesting. I've got one question based on what you said. Oops. In using... For people who weren't familiar with SNAP, is that not creating a barrier to usage just as much as other ones? Surely it would be better to be not using a customized theme or course design and actually working with one of the default ones. Or, if people are using SNAP, offer them the ability to change the theme at a user level, that they can choose Boost, Clean, or SNAP.
I can respond to that. So as far as Boost is concerned, there's still an accessibility issue that we've reported to Moodle HQ that until that's fixed, Boost is kind of out of the question. As far as Clean's concerned, we really wanted to try and minimize scrolling. SNAP did result in some scrolling action, but that was another one of the reasons why we leaned towards SNAP more so, was because we wanted to avoid the scroll of death.
I think the scroll of death thing is something which is not really such an issue when you think about Twitter, Facebook, and a lot of websites out there actually infinitely scroll. So I think it's an overplayed point, but I do get it. It's just most people wouldn't be familiar with Snap. So if you want to go with the Pareto rule, you know, you're going with something which the minority will be aware of. But anyway, anyone else got a question there?
And so it's and my navigation video showed how to use SNAP, but people just didn't tend to. Let me just, if you want to see what I created, I'll just, there's a.
I like SNAP. That's not the point. It was just the fact that it's a non-default thing, so I'm concerned.
Yeah. We'd like to switch to Boost, but something we'll reevaluate at a later time for sure.
earlier you mentioned a product called, was it H5P?
Yep.
So it's just 5 digits?
And then the number of as Eric said, some are accessible, some are not, but we're in touch with that company. Presentation here at the Moodle Moot on H5P. Who's doing that? I forget who's doing that. Is that you, Gavin? Nope. Andy.
Yeah. Andy's already done it. He did it earlier, yeah. No, it's a plugin.
We've really just really tapped out our audience, which I don't think that's ever going to happen because the technologies will always be changing. So we'll see.
And each offering of the MOOC is going to be a little bit different because we're just going to continue to add more content to each time.
Thank you.
Didn't hurt anything. So would it hurt anything if I signed up again? For the one in October?
Okay. Didn't complete, you know, you have to self-enroll, and they didn't complete the whole self-enrollment process, and then like 3 weeks later they said, why am I not in the MOOC? So I have those names, and I'll personally contact those people. If you give me your name, I'll make sure and personally contact you.
And I would just throw in there that, so for the pilot of the MOOC, we had that 100 participant cap, which kind of complicated the registration process.
Right.
So for future offerings of the MOOC, there won't be that participant cap. So the registration is going to be a lot more streamlined.
Yes. Yeah, watch that Ally site for information about that. We had people signing up, you know, early during the first week. But once we get rolling into the second week, you're too far behind and you've missed a whole discussion or two. So you really have to sign up before it starts or right during the first week and get going. Yes, thank you.
Hello. There we go. So thank you very much for your presentation, and it looks really very interesting. I think some of the topics you're tackling there are absolutely critical for people to learn and understand. So thank you very much, both of you, for that.